Father, again, we thank you that we're able to gather together to learn the Bible, to open this book, to find out about your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for the freedoms that we have tonight to do so. Father, we do pray for our safety tonight, that you would keep us free from incident, free from anyone that would come into this church and mean harm, whether it be physical or legal. Please just continue to protect our churches that teach truth. Father, we thank you for the Spirit of God who indwells us. We ask you tonight that yet again, for the 100 millionth time in our lives, that God the Holy Spirit would be our teacher, that He would comfort us, that He would guide us in all truth, that He would remind us as we go through Mark chapter 2, that He would remind us of things that we've already been taught in the Scriptures, that we would be able to make connections in the Word to make these things more and more rich and more real in our lives. And Father, more than anything, we ask that these things that we learn, these truths that we pick up from the Scriptures that you reveal to us, we would be able to use them in our lives, not just collect like they're memorabilia, but actually use in our lives, apply to our lives as we strive to please you and become more and more Christ-like in our thoughts and in our actions day to day. We love you, Lord. We serve you, we lift up this time to you, and we ask and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So who can forgive sins but God alone? Yet another controversy of Jesus. Controversy with guess who? The scribes and the Pharisees. They're going to gang together or gang up on Jesus yet again here in Mark chapter 2. Before we go there, though, I just want to define sin just very, very simply, because the question is, and this answer is important while we go through this, who can forgive sins? It's important to understand what sin is. The Greek word for sin is hamartia, and it means to miss the mark. Very literally, it means to miss a bullseye. We all shoot guns or shoot bows and arrows from time to time, whatever. You know what a bullseye is with its concentric rings going out? The bullseye is the middle ring. And literally what this word hamartia speaks of is missing the bullseye, missing the mark. When we talk about sin in the Christian's life or in the unbeliever's life, they're lost in sin too. We're talking about missing the bullseye of God's absolute righteousness. We're talking about not attaining to the righteousness of God by a word, a deed, an action, etc. So it's an offense. The bottom line is, it's an offense against God. Sin is an offense against God. So we start here, against God. Remember this, an offense against God. Who can forgive sins but God alone? Why would God be the only one who can forgive sins? Because it's an offense against God. In Mark chapter 2, verse 1, it says, when he had come back from Capernaum, we're talking about Jesus. When Jesus had come back to Capernaum several days afterward, it was heard that he was at home. Now, Jesus spent considerable time in Peter's home. This is likely the home of the Apostle Peter, where Peter lived with his wife and his mother-in-law from other accounts. And this is what it says in good old Jewish tradition. A Jew doesn't have to be invited to your house to come over to your house and come into your life. And in good old Jewish tradition, we read in verse 2, many were gathered together so that there was no longer room, not even at the door. And Jesus was speaking the word to them. So they were crammed into, if it's Peter's house, it doesn't matter. They were crammed into this home, so much so that there was no room for anyone else to enter. They were packed in there. We call it standing room only nowadays. That is the fact of the matter here. In a house in Capernaum that's jammed full of Jews. This city is in the Galilee. It's along the western, northwestern shore of the Sea of Galilee. It's right on the shores. This is the city where Peter and Andrew had their fishing enterprise, where John and James, the sons of Zebedee, were their fishing partners. This is where they were from, Capernaum, on the Sea of Galilee. It says they came bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. Paralytic is the Greek word paralytikos. It's exactly the way it sounds. A paralytic is a person who's disabled in his feet or in his legs. A paralytic is a person that can't walk because he has a disability in either his feet or his legs or both. That's what a paralytic is. So the paralytic can't walk to go see Jesus. Have to frame the event here. The paralytic can't walk to go see Jesus like the rest of the city of Capernaum did. The paralytic had to be carried, and it says that four of his friends carried him. In verse 4 it says, being unable to get to Jesus. Why? Because of the crowd. Being unable to get to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And when they had dug an opening, they let down the pallet on which the paralytic was lying. So imagine this pallet. It's some sort of wooden frame that they're carrying, like we would call a gurney or something. They're carrying this man on a wooden frame that they have made, probably has some sort of animal skin across it. The man is laying on it. They've got one on either pole, and they're carrying this man in. They can't get him in. These houses in Capernaum, I've seen them. I've seen this house that is possibly the house Jesus was in. I'm trying to find something that's the approximate size of the stones. These houses were built out of stones that are about 18 inches to 2 feet wide and about 18 inches tall. They were big squares like this, and one laid upon another is how they built these houses. Those were the walls, very thick walls. They would have had a flat wooden roof of poles across them. And then in the poles, they lay sod, they lay clay, they mush together grass, they make clay tiles and put the clay tiles on the very top. So we're talking about a roof that may have been that fat, that thick. That's why it says they dug through it. It's not plywood and roof tiles that we have, roof shingles. Very, very different level of type of construction, and it would have been a flat roof. That's why often they would go outside at night on their roofs in the heat of the day or in the cool of the evening to cool off. That's what's going on here. They can't get inside, so they have lifted this man up onto the roof, and they're digging their way through the roof, through the ceiling. Now, if that was happening here, we would know it. I'm telling you that Jesus is teaching them the Word of God. Was He teaching them about the kingdom of heaven being at hand? We don't know what He was teaching at the moment, but He was giving them Bible truth, scroll truth. Maybe He was in the book of Isaiah. We have no idea what Jesus was teaching to this group, but He was teaching truth to them. And while this is happening, there are four men on the roof digging through the roof, a hole big enough to drop a pallet with a full-size man on it through the ceiling. This was going on, and it was known by the people in the house. This could not have been done in secret. It would have been a massive hole, but it didn't start a massive hole. It started a little hole, and it got chipped away and chipped away. And I can imagine things were falling down on the people in the room as this is going on. Just trying to paint a picture for what's happening here. It's an astounding event. So they dug an opening and they let down the pallet on which the paralytic was lying. And this was Jesus' response as He's teaching the Word and all this is going on. I can imagine Him looking up and everybody looking around. What is going on? Jesus doesn't miss a beat. He continues teaching all this time. When the man is finally, the hole is big enough and he's lowered down to the floor in front of Jesus, Jesus, seeing their faith, said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Very interesting things going on here. Jesus sees the faith it takes for these four men to dig through the ceiling, through the roof of this house to lower this man. Faith is the word pistis in the Greek, P-I-S-T-I-S. And it means to have strong confidence. To have strong confidence, to have a reliance or a trust in someone or something. These people had faith. They had strong confidence. These four men and the paralytic man had strong confidence and trust that if they could get that man to Jesus' presence, Jesus could heal him. And Jesus understood their faith as they're doing what they're doing while he's teaching. These men believed without doubt that Jesus could perform the miracle of healing this man who had never walked. And they took apart Peter's roof to lower their friend into the presence of Jesus Christ. They dug through the roof to lower this man into the presence of Jesus Christ. And Jesus links their faith with the miracle. He does that. Listen to that statement again. Jesus links faith with the miracle that he performed. He performed a miracle because people had faith. Remember this morning, the fifth question that Paul asked the Galatians. Does God provide the Holy Spirit to you and do these miracles among you because of the works of the law or because of your faith? And even in Jesus' time, it was faith that triggered the miracles. I'm going to give you several verses here. I want you to write them down. What I'm trying to say is God does miracles, these miracles of healings, because of people's faith, not because they earned the healing by their works. The signs and the miracles aren't being done because this paralytic was a wonderful non-sinning man. What Jesus just told him is you're a sinner and your sins are now forgiven. These are the verses where Jesus links faith with miracles. From the book of Luke, Luke chapter 7 verse 9. Luke chapter 8, verse 25. Luke chapter 8, verse 48. I'll start over. Luke 7, 9. Luke 8, 25. I feel like a bingo caller. Luke 8, 48. Luke 8, 50. I'm going to read these verses to you in a minute. Luke 17, 19. 17, verse 19. And one more, Luke 18, verse 42. Jesus links faith, not works, not deserving, not earnings, but faith with the miracles that he performs in these verses. Now listen to me, read them to you. Luke 7, 9, to the Gentile, not the Jew, to the Gentile centurion, Jesus said this, I say to you, not even in Israel have I found such great faith. In Luke 8, verse 25, Jesus rebukes the wind. This is Jesus on the Sea of Galilee with his disciples asleep. The wind is causing the boat to be tumultuously swept back and forth. They're afraid they're going to drown. Jesus rebukes the wind and he asks his disciples in the boat, where's your faith? See, the miracle is linked to faith. In Luke 8, verse 48, to the bleeding woman, the woman who had hemorrhage for, what was it, 12 years or something? Jesus says, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. See, the miracle is connected to faith, not to works, not to deserving, not to earning. The miracles are connected to faith. In Luke chapter 8, verse 50, to the synagogue official named Jairus, Jairus, about his 12-year-old daughter, Jesus said this, do not be afraid any longer, only believe, pistis, only have faith, and she will be made well. This is when people had come and said, don't bother the rabbi any longer, your daughter is dead. Your daughter has died, your 12-year-old daughter is gone. Jesus is on the way to her when the hemorrhaging woman comes up to him and touches his robe. He heals her. He continues on. They say the little girl is dead. Don't bother the man anymore. And Jesus has that to say. Do not be afraid any longer. Only believe and she will be made well. Faith. The miracle is attached to faith. In Luke 17, verse 19, to the Gentile leper, another Gentile miracle of healing. The Gentile leper bowing at the feet of Jesus Christ. Jesus says to him, rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well. Why did I perform the miracle? Why did I heal you? Because you had faith in me. You knew that I could heal you. Are these salvation events? No, I don't think so. Were they saved either right before or right after? Most likely. But these healings don't necessarily have to do with salvation from hell. The faith that he's talking about is you believe that me as Jesus could heal you. And then they went on this road to further truth. Just because he heals somebody doesn't mean they understand he's the Son of God that's going to pay for the sins of the world. There was more to it. But in Luke, the last one, in Luke 18, verse 42, to the blind man who believed Jesus could give him his sight back, Jesus said this, recover your sight, your faith has made you well. Recover your sight, your faith has made you well. Are all these people believers? Yeah, I without question, I would say absolutely. But not because of the healing, maybe as a result of the healing. They had to believe in Jesus Christ as their Savior, as their sin bearer. That may have been a different event at the same time, but a different set of facts. So Jesus here in Mark chapter 2 links faith with the healing. But listen to what happens here. It says, Jesus seeing their faith. Who's the there? Who are the men? It's these four men and the fifth man, the paralytic. They all had faith enough to dig through Peter's roof to lower this man to Jesus. So the four friends of the paralyzed man dig through the grass, they dig through the clay, they dig through the clay tiles, and they make a hole in the roof through which to lower this paralytic man. Jesus sees their great faith in him, and he heals the man of his paralyzed legs. Isn't that what it says? Or is that not what it says in verse 5? It says, Jesus, seeing their faith, said to the paralytic, not rise up and walk. What he said was, son, your sins are forgiven. So the paralytic is laying on his pallet, a man forgiven of his sins now, but still a man who can't walk. And you wonder just exactly what is going on here. A couple of thoughts and then we move forward. I'll explain that. Number one, in this event, Jesus doesn't skip a beat in his teaching. He keeps on teaching during the commotion on the roof. That was the most important thing he did that day in that house was teach. So no matter what was going on, he didn't stop. He continued to teach. Number two, he recognizes the great faith in these five men. Number three, he turns to the paralytic man and he calls the man son. Son is the Greek word technon, T-E-K-N-O-N, and it's a term of endearment for a child. My little children, John calls his disciples, the people that listen to him teach to them, my little children. Jesus calls this man my little child, my tender son. It's a word of great compassion, great empathy, great love. He calls him technon, my little child. So he turns to the paralytic man and he calls him son. And the fourth thing, Jesus forgives the paralytic man his sins. He doesn't heal his legs. Got to go through these things slowly and see how Jesus is developing a lesson here. A lesson for the Pharisees and the scribes. And for everyone. But especially them. And he comes out of the Old Testament perfectly. So he forgives the paralytic man's sins first. And you ask what's going on here. Psalm 103. Turn to Psalm 103 with me quickly. I'll make this statement while you're turning to Psalm 103. In the Jewish age, remember Jesus lives in the Jewish age, yes? In the age of Israel, disease was viewed as the consequence of man's sinful condition. A man like a paralytic was considered to be a sinner, and that's why he was a paralytic. In the Jewish thinking, in the Jewish age thinking, if you were paralyzed, it was because you sinned or your parents sinned. That was their thinking. That was their default thought. They see someone that's paralyzed, he's a sinner or his parents were a sinner. I hope that's ringing a bell. He's a sinner or his parents are a sinner. I'll show you in verse in just a minute. But you were healed from an ailment only after God forgave your sins. There's a progression here. Look what it says in Psalm 103, verse 1 to 3. David says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul. Bless the Lord and all." I'm sorry, I'll start over. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name." And then he says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget none of His benefits." What He does for me, what He does for my soul. And then he gives a list of things. And the first thing in verse 3 in the list is, "Who pardons all our sins." The second thing in the list is, "Who heals all our diseases." There's an order to these events. The sinner is forgiven and then he is healed. Now listen again. In the Jewish mind, it makes logical sense. Just listen to me. In the Jewish mind, if you have an ailment or you have a disease or a condition like this paralytic, in the Jewish mind, it's because of sin. So until the sin barrier is removed with God, you will continue in your ailment. You get it? Until you do something about the sin, until God forgives the sin, how can the ailment go away? It cannot. That's the Jewish mind. I'm not preaching this to a New Testament church. I'm teaching you what the Jewish mind is, AD 33. There's an order to these events. The paralytic Jewish man living in the Jewish age was in this category. So Jesus forgave his sins first, and then he healed him of his ailment, as we'll see in just a minute. But I don't want you to jump to conclusions and look around at everyone and start saying, "Oh, well, he's got this, he's a sinner, she's got that, she's a sinner." No conclusions. Let's turn to the Word of God. Look in John chapter 9. John chapter 9, New Testament, but is it the Jewish age or is it the age of Israel? I mean, the church age. It's the Jewish age. It's the Jewish age. Acts chapter 2 is when the church begins. John is written in the age of Israel. And look what it says in John chapter 9. This is what I said earlier. Is your mind going somewhere with these thoughts? Did he sin or did his parents sin? The point is, and here's the fact, ailment, sickness, and disease are not always the result of sin. They are not always the result of sin. That's simply the Jewish mental default. That's how they believed. And look, even the disciples here, I'm proving to you that this is how the Jewish mind believed at this time. As he passed by Jesus, he saw a man blind from birth. What does the Jewish mind immediately think? Somebody sinned. This man has an ailment. This man has a disease. This man has a defect because of sin. That is the Jewish mental default. Look at what they said. His disciples, these are the men following Jesus, the women following Jesus. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned? This man or his parents that he would be born blind?" It was the default. And Jesus, thank goodness that this verse is in the scripture, Jesus frees us from that Jewish thinking. Jesus said it was neither that this man sinned nor his parents. This is not an issue of sin, this blind man. This man has been blind all his life for this day. This man is blind so that the works of God might be displayed in him. So this man was chosen in the plan of God to be blind all the years of his life until the days of Jesus of Nazareth, who came and healed him from his blindness. The bottom line is God has his own reasons. You deal with your own ailments, your own illnesses, your own diseases before the Lord. Could you have an ailment because of sin? Yes. Could you have an ailment because God has a design that you'll never know about until you get to heaven? Yes. I'm a much better judge of whether my ailments are sin generated or whether they're not. So I don't judge you and you don't judge me. Not when it comes to that. There are reasons to keep people accountable, but this is one we have no business in. This man is blind neither because he sinned or his parents, but so that the works of God might be displayed in him. But back to the story in Mark chapter 2, the paralytic, Jesus' first order of events with this man was to forgive his sins. And that started the controversy. What's the question we started with? Who can forgive sins but God alone? If a sin is an offense against a holy and righteous God, then who can say that sin is forgiven unless you're God Himself? Verse 6 says, but some of the scribes, and when you go to the account in the book of Luke, it mentions that the Pharisees were also in this gang. But Mark only mentions the scribes here, but it's the scribes and the Pharisees. But some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts. This is what they were thinking. Why does this man speak that way? He is blaspheming. Remember what the word blaspheme means? To say offensive things about God or religion. He's saying offensive things about the God of Israel. He's blaspheming, saying, who can forgive sins? Or they say, who can forgive sins but God alone? The great question in their minds is, this man is blaspheming because he says he can forgive sins. We say that no one can forgive sins but God. We need to catch this man. How can we prove that he is blaspheming, that he actually didn't forgive this man's sins? They're in a quandary here. So Jesus is accused of blasphemy, speaking offensive things against God. And you say, what's offensive against God? All he said was, son, your sins are forgiven. This is the problem. Jesus is taking onto himself the prerogative of God to forgive man's sins. He's just a carpenter from Nazareth. And he says to another human being, your sins are forgiven. He's taking the role of God because no one can forgive sins but God. A quick definition of forgiveness. Forgiveness is an act in which an offense is no longer held against another. An act in which an offense is no longer held against another. So this Jesus of Nazareth is telling that man, that paralytic, that paralyzed man, the God of heaven no longer holds your sins against you. That's what forgiveness is. It's a release of a debt to God. And Jesus has taken it upon himself, the power and authority of God, to tell a man that God no longer holds that offense against you. Again, if a sin is an offense against God, who can forgive sins but God alone, right? So the Pharisees and scribes, I have a question for you. The Pharisees and scribes say that only God can forgive sins. My question is, are they taking this from Bible knowledge, or is this just one of their traditions? Come on. Look at Leviticus verse 24. Yes, they're taking this from Bible knowledge. I'm sorry, not Leviticus, Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9. I ask you that question because most of the controversies Jesus gets in with the scribes and Pharisees have to do with their traditions. But they're right on this one. If that man's not God and he's saying he's forgiving sins, then he needs to be killed. And they're right about that too. Look at what it says in Daniel chapter 9 concerning who forgives sins in verse 9. Daniel 9, verse 9. To the Lord our God belong compassion and forgiveness. You can put a period after that. To the Lord our God belong compassion and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against Him. Our offense is against the living God. The only one who can wipe away the offense is the living God. To the Lord our God belong compassion and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against Him. Yes, only God can forgive sins. Only God can forgive sins. If sins are an affront and an offense against God, then only God can lift the penalty of that sin. I can't tell you your sin is forgiven before the Lord. We can forgive each other personally, but the sin against the Father in whatever we have done to each other, that has to be confessed before Him. It's His prerogative to forgive us, not ours. That's why the Scripture says if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us, not each other. I'm not going to go down that road any further. Another time I want you to go back to Psalm 103, and then we'll finish this story. Psalm 103. I should have told you to stay there earlier. Remember Psalm 103, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget none of His benefits. The Lord who pardons all your sins, who heals all your diseases. I take you to Psalm 103 for this great comfort. Look down to verse 12. You know this verse. Not only does to this God belong compassion and forgiveness, but when He forgives entirely. Psalm 103 verse 12 says, as far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. When you look at a globe of the earth, you see a south pole on it and a north pole. We spin on that axis of north and south. Those are defined points on the earth. Where's the east pole and the west pole? They don't exist. The earth just continuously rotates around and around and around. There is no east and west distance. It's infinite. And that's the point here. If He says, as far as the north is from the south, so far has He removed our transgressions from us, well, that's a long way, but it's not a complete thing, because those are two points on this globe. But when He says, as far as the east is from the west, we're talking about an immeasurable distance that continues infinitely. It's that distance that God has taken you and removed your sins from you and thrown them in that direction, east or west, never to be associated with you again. He's removed that offense from you. As far as the east is from the west, that's why Paul can boldly, confidently say, these things I do, I forget what lays behind. And I pressed forward toward the prize of the upward call. Because the Father's forgiven the sins as far as the east is from the west. Thank goodness we have a Father that's compassionate and to whom belongs forgiveness. As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. But that's Almighty God, not this lowly carpenter, Jesus of Nazareth. So I ask the question, did Jesus blaspheme or not? Jesus tells the man, your sins are forgiven. Look at Leviticus chapter 24. See, this is a really hard thing to determine. If you're on the ground in Capernaum, in Peter's house, when Jesus tells this man this, how do you determine if God has truly removed the offensive sin from this man? You can't do it. It can't be done. Maybe the man's sins are forgiven. Maybe the man's sins aren't forgiven. You can't tell. It's an internal, invisible event. But what if Jesus did blaspheme? In Leviticus chapter 24, verse 15, the Pharisees and the scribes are right about this. If this man is blaspheming, then they need to bring a charge against him and stone him. Look what it says in verse 15. Leviticus 24, verse 15. You shall speak to the sons of Israel. Say this, if anyone curses his God, then he will bear his sin. Verse 16. Moreover, the one who blasphemes the name of the Lord shall surely be put to death. If you say something offensive, untrue against the living God, you shall surely be put to death. All the congregation shall certainly stone him. If they could prove that Jesus really didn't forgive that man's sins, but how do they prove it? It's an impossibility. Then they could stone him to death. It ends by saying the alien as well as the native, when he blasphemes the name, he shall be put to death. The name there is the Hebrew phrase Hashem, H-A-S-H-E-M, the name. Ha is the Greek article, Hebrew article. You hear a lot of Jews, I say that because you hear a lot of Jews refer to God, to Yahweh, as Hashem. Listen for that when you listen to Jews, listen to them on the internet or in person, wherever you hear them, they will call God Hashem, the name. That's where they get it from, the book of Leviticus. Back to Mark chapter 2, let's close out here. Jesus has forgiven this man's sins. The Pharisees and the scribes are up in arms. Who can forgive sins but God alone? This man blasphemes. The only thing they don't know is, my goodness, what if he really did speak on behalf of God and that man's sins really are forgiven? How can we prove that Jesus is a blasphemer here? So Jesus digs in a little deeper. You want proof? I'll give you proof. A bold, bold man, this Jesus. Verse 8 says, immediately Jesus, aware in his spirit internally, he knew, he was aware in his spirit that they were reasoning that way within themselves, the scribes and the Pharisees. And so he said to them, why are you reasoning about these things in your hearts? Which is easier? Which is less difficult for a man to do? To say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven? Or to say, get up, pick up your pallet, and walk? Which would they say is an easier thing to do? You just blurt out some words. Son, your sins are forgiven. That's an easy thing to do, you blasphemer. So Jesus said, okay, I understand why you're reasoning. I get your point. I'm going to give you proof. You don't think I can forgive sins. You don't think that I have the power and the authority of God, of heaven here. So in verse 10, Jesus says, "But so that you may know that the Son of Man," it just gives me chills. Here Jesus calling down the name of Daniel chapter 7, the Son of Man who would receive a kingdom, a dominion, an eternal dominion from the Ancient of Days in heaven. The Son of Man, Jesus calls Himself. Make no mistake, He's referring to Himself here in the third person, so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. He said to the paralytic, "I say to you, get up, pick up your pallet, and go home." If that paralytic gets up, then Jesus has proven astounding things in the town of Capernaum. He has proven that He is the Son of Man of Daniel chapter 7, whose dominion will have no end. "I'm the King of Israel." He's proven that a man on earth has the authority of God in heaven. He's no ordinary man. He's the God-man. And He's also proven that that man's sins were indeed forgiven when He said, "Technon, son, my dear child, little child, your sins are forgiven." If that paralytic stands up, the scribes and the Pharisees have trouble on their hands because the God of Israel is in their midst. And why they didn't get it, I just don't know. Why they wouldn't have seen this and heard this. These teachers of the law, the most learned men in all of Israel, hearing the phrase from Daniel, "Son of Man," they knew exactly who the Son of Man would be. They knew exactly that He would be the King, the Messiah. And Jesus says this, if that man's sins aren't forgiven, then he won't get up. But to prove to you that that man's sins are forgiven, son, stand up and go home. And that should have been the end of it. His logic, his reasoning was so perfect. Verse 12 says, and he got up. He didn't have to think about it. He heard Jesus say, stand up. I mean, he looks down at legs that have never had strength in them before. He didn't question, well, can I do this, Lord? Can I really do this? He just stood up. In obedience to the command of his God, he stood up. He got up and immediately picked up the pallet and went out in the sight of everyone so that they were all amazed. The Greek word literally means they were out of their minds. They were losing. This was such an amazement to them. This man that they had known all his life, not able to walk, who gets up. They have lost their mental composure here. They're amazed at what Jesus just did. And we're glorifying God. You see, the miracle, because of the faith of the five men designed to bring people to faith in the living God, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, it worked in Capernaum. But not with the scribes and the Pharisees. They were glorifying God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." The audience, the Jews that were cram-packed in Peter's house, were forced by the way Jesus Christ played this event, down to the nitty-gritty of the Old Testament fact of forgiveness of sins and then the healing. It was all proper. It was all perfect, but the way He played it was genius. They were forced to recognize that this man's sins indeed were forgiven by God, or else he would not have been healed and stood up to walk. That was Jesus' challenge to them. To show you that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, young man, stand up and walk and go home. And he did. I asked earlier, did Jesus blaspheme or not? The answer, if yes, was that the congregation shall certainly stone him. But the answer, if no, if Jesus did not blaspheme on this day, then Jesus, the God of heaven incarnate, had forgiven this man of his sins and healed him. Jesus of Nazareth has to be the God of heaven. And they say Jesus never claimed to be God again, so that the Son of Man has, to show you that the Son of Man has authority. He claimed the title from Daniel chapter 7 of the eternal King whose dominion would never end, the King of Israel, the Messiah, God Himself. If He was a blasphemer, He should be stoned. Because He's not a blasphemer, and He proved it, He should be worshipped as God. And thank goodness, it does my heart good to read that some of these people glorified God. I'll never understand why the Pharisees just gritted their teeth and dug down deeper. The heart of man is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who could know it? The controversy of Jesus in forgiveness of sins. I enjoyed it. I hope you did too. Let's close in prayer. Father, thank You for the time You've given us to look into Your Word tonight. Thank You that in the person of Jesus Christ, we can see how deftly He handled humanity. How He was wise as a serpent and harmless as a dove, as He told us to be in this time on earth. Thank You for the unveiling of the truth in the Scriptures, without question, that Jesus is the God of heaven. He is the Messiah. He is the Son of Man. And as such, as the God of heaven, He had the power, the authority, and the ability to forgive men's sins while He was here on earth. Thank You for this man, Jesus of Nazareth. And we ask all these things and thank You in His name. Amen.